What's up, everyone? This is my podcast with Trevor Pinch, professor of sociology at Cornell University. Trevor is a leading expert in science and technology studies and has a profound knowledge on the interactions between science, technology, and society. In my podcast, we will talk about crashing planes, macho bikes, psychedelic music, synthesizers, transcontinental cables, solar neutrinos, social constructivism, self-driving cars, and the limits of artificial intelligence, including appearances ranging from John Cage to Elon Musk. Enjoy. Thanks, Trevor, for coming on my podcast. So you are physicist by training, musician by passion, and sociologist by profession. So what brought you there to be a sociologist?
Ah, that's a really good question. I was always interested in science as a kid, and I went to Imperial College London to study physics, and it was the tail end of the 60s, the early 70s. The 1960s went into the 70s in terms of being student protest, experimental, countercultural era. And I fell in with interesting people in Imperial College, a little countercultural group. And to be quite honest, physics wasn't as exciting as I expected it to be. I thought I'd sort of pictured myself doing experiments at the research frontier, checking out if it was, you know, matter was waves or particles or something like that. And in fact, it was boring doing all these problem sets in these large, rather boring lectures. So I looked around for something more interesting to do, and I found that Imperial College offered a little minority option in something called, something just flashed on my screen there.
And then the connection was lost. Why? Because you cannot say anything bad about physics.
So you may have heard me say that it's good to think in terms of the physics approach of first principles, which is, rather than reasoning by analogy, you boil things down to the most fundamental truths you can imagine and you reason up from there. And this is a good way to figure out if something really makes sense or if it's just what everybody else is doing.
Thanks, Elon. When the connection was back, here's what happened. All right. So Trevor, you have established the Department of Science and Technology Studies at Cornell. So science and technology sounds like dealing with almost everything that matters. So what is it about?
Yeah, so the field is science and technology studies. It's this kind of new interdisciplinary field. And in 1990, I was invited by Cornell University to come over from England and help form a new graduate program in this field. Now, typically in this field, people have undergraduate degrees in science or engineering and a higher degree like a PhD in either the humanities or social science or political science or something like that. In my case, I had the undergrad degree in physics and the PhD in sociology. So we have a big undergraduate major in what's known as biology and society in particular, and these are mainly students who are going on to become medics in that undergraduate major, but they do other work as well. And yeah, it covers basically the relationship between society and engineering and science and medicine. All those things are covered in it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so yeah, you say relationship. So I want to dig a little bit deeper into that, in particular, so which direction and which way matters. So I looked a little bit around, and so there's something on the internet, I just like read it now. So quote, social construction of technology, also referred as to SCOT, so SCOT, is a theory within the field of science and technology studies. So advocates of SCOT, that is social constructivists, argue that technology does not determine human action, but then rather human action shapes technology. So, I mean, I understand that is only one part of this error I'm just like trying to describe. So I have never built a radio or designed a satellite or a smartphone. So how do I shape technology?
Great question. So most work in the sociology of technology actually looks at the relationship between technology and society, where it's the impact of technology on society. And that's all pretty familiar. you know, that do computers put people out of work? How right. does Google affect your ability to memorize things? Things like that. So the impact of technology on society is pretty well known and pretty well studied. The innovation of this social construction technology approach, which was developed by myself and another scholar, a Dutch scholar called Wiebe Baker in the early 1980s, is to look at relationships the other way, to try and see how society gets inside of technology. And that's much harder to see, but it's actually much more important, because most people think of technological artifacts, for instance, like things like electronic music synthesizers, which I've studied, or bicycles or cars, these are things I've written about, as being kind of neutral objects. And so the fact, if you can show how society is embedded in these objects, and by society can mean cultural assumptions as well, embedded in these objects, then these objects are incredibly powerful, because people don't, they're kind of almost secret carriers of social relations. So if you want an example of this, actually one of the best examples is the one I studied. Yeah. A very simple example, the electronic music synthesizer is a keyboard now. It's an electronic keyboard. Now, I researched the history of this, and it doesn't have to be a keyboard. In the early days, in the 1960s, when these machines were being developed, there were other ways of controlling them. You could control them with wands and strange devices that you pushed, which weren't like a keyboard. And eventually, Robert Moog, who's a Cornell engineer, developed a keyboard synthesizer, and that took off and became the predominant design for every electronic music synthesizer since, which is like a kind of portable keyboard. But the keyboard is about a certain form of music. It's about, you know, the chromatic scale, the 12 notes of the chromatic scale are kind of embedded into that instrument. But we know music doesn't have to be in chromatic scales. It can be about sweeps and gestures. And there was much more avant-garde synthesizers available in the 1960s, which used these wands rather than a keyboard. So the keyboard became the predominant design, and the keyboard carries forward the culture, a particular culture of music. So it's like we as society, music is a societal thing, just not want music in a particular way, and that gets embedded into the synthesizer. But you have a different notion, sorry, yeah.
Yeah, so what was then before the synthesizer? So classical instruments, or you mentioned some of them, but so
there were a few.
What was a big transition to the synthesizer?
Well, there were, you know, pianos and harpsichords, okay. There were other keyboards, and there were electric organs around. And there was an early experimental electronic music instrument called Thurman, after the Russian inventor Lev Thurman in the 1920s. And that was a bizarre instrument. You played it without a keyboard, actually. And that's interesting, that instrument never stabilized. It was a marginal instrument used for special effects in Hollywood movies. Every time a space alien appears, you hear this wailing sound, which is a theremin. Mm-hmm. But it never stabilized as a musical instrument, although there were classical performers of the theremin, and there were pieces of classical music written for it. The synthesizer is one of those rare things, which is a completely new instrument. You can go in any music store in the world and buy a synthesizer. It's usually a portable keyboard device these days. There are, of course, software synths as well online, but that's the main form of the artifact. And so what I'm saying is that this artifact of the synthesizer just looks like a simple box sitting there, you know, like your computer sits there. But it's actually carrying certain, in this case, notions of music with it, which we as society deem as that's an acceptable form of music, is embedded into that synthesizer. So it's really, if you don't believe in the 12 notes of the chromatic scale, you want to make sort of avant-garde electronic music, which is sweeps of sound, say, like John Cage would argue we should be doing.
My name is John Cage. I'm from Stony Point, New York.
John Cage, politician?
Yes.
John Cage.
The musician?
He's a composer.
Yeah.
He is probably the most controversial figure in the musical world today, and when you hear his performance, if you'll forgive me, you will understand why. All right, let's see this instrument.
Great, thank you.
Then it's really hard to do that sort of music on that conventional synthesizer with those keyboards. So the synthesizer looks kind of neutral, but it's carrying forward certain sorts of relations within it. Yeah. That's what social constructed technology is about.
So I remember, I think there's also piano, so which is based on quarter notes. So like for every 12, there are like two or one in between sort of. And so these analog instrument, I have seen recently a movie on YouTube where the performer was quite good. So the performer hit like really every tone. So I think maybe there was also is an improvement over the time, because you mentioned that it was not really stable. So so maybe modern instruments now could even stabilize. But I get the idea, because the synthesizer, like by definition or by construction, it stabilizes the tone because it's based on oscillators, right? So that was sort of the breakthrough, that you don't have to fight with the instrument, for example, the piano, if it's well tempered, it's well tempered, but other instruments you always have to fight to really be able to play it.
Well, these early synthesizers, as you're pointing out, were based on things called oscillators, the source of sound, and they were very unstable, actually, in the early days. Heat would affect them. So you have a typical scenario, but you tune the instrument up before the concert, the roadies would check it. Then you had the concert, the heat of the audience being there would put the oscillators out of tune. So this is a very familiar thing to one of the big rock performers who first used the Moog big modular synthesizer, Keith Emerson of Emerson, Lake and Palmer. And Keith was so familiar with the synthesizer going out of tune in the middle of playing some complicated piece that Emerson, Lake and Palmer would play. He'd say to the band, freak out moment. So the synthesizer would go out of tune, and you know, they play that kind of avant-garde psychedelic type music at that point, which you didn't need a key to play in. Right. So musicians are skilled people, and humans are basically compensating for the deficiencies of the machine and doing their own thing with it. And that's always the story of technology. You know, when say, here's a piece of technology, Siri. When Siri says something stupid to you on your iPhone, we compensate for it. We know that she doesn't really mean that, or she's mistaking what we're saying. So humans are skilled with technology as well in compensating the deficiencies of the technology.
Right.
So it's very interesting, these complicated relations between humans and technology. That's what basically we study in this field.
Yeah. So yeah, let me come back maybe a little bit later. So I like the psychedelic music production. So I think you also did it at some point.
Yeah, I'm an amateur musician myself, and I've been playing all my life different instruments. And yeah, I play in a band where we do a kind of ambient chill out electronic music that's very psychedelic influenced. Yeah.
Yeah. But you recorded CDs or something, musical CDs or?
Yeah. No? Oh yeah. Yeah. I played in a rock band called the Atomic Forces. We played a big gig, was at the Bowery Ballroom in New York City. That was a thrill. And I play in avant-garde duo called Electric Golem.
Thank you.
Right.
We make our CDs. Yeah, you can buy them on eBay or whatever, or CD Baby.
Yeah. Okay. Let's come back to Scott, because I would like really to have maybe a little bit more examples or to better understand it. So also quote from the internet, they also argue that the ways the technology is used cannot be understood without understanding how the technology is embedded in its context or social context. So Scott is a response to technological determinism and sometimes known as technological constructivism. So is that what we have talked about, or where is actually, so what I'm missing so far is this recursion taking place in our society, so back and forth. So far I have the idea it's like a static construct, but so me as a physicist, I'm very pretty much interested in dynamics. Can you say more about this back and forth, this recursion process, which makes it for me as a physicist interesting?
Okay, well, here's an example. I mentioned earlier, maybe I didn't mention, that I've been studying the history of the automobile in America. And so we looked at this, I did this with a colleague at Cornell, a historian of technology, Ron Klein. We looked at the history of the Model T motor car, really important, produced by Henry Ford, in the history of motor cars. And we found that users of this technology in farms in the 1920s and 30s were doing strange things with their Model Ts. They were jacking them up and using them as a stationary source of power to power things like a domestic washing machine for doing the laundry. Mm-hmm. They were turning them into tractors to plow fields, all sorts of things. These farmers are users of this technology, and they're incredibly innovative. Now, the manufacturers, of course, respond to this. So this is the backwards and forwards. So Henry Ford and other companies developed kits to help users turn their Model T into this static source of power. But at the same time, Henry Ford was also, and other companies were also developing their separate sources of power. For plowing a field, Henry Ford had the Fordson tractor coming out, which was a dedicated unit, which was a tractor. So at some point when he had the tractor, he didn't want people jacking up their cars or adding big wheels to their cars to turn them into tractors. So anyone who sold these kits wouldn't get the Ford dealership anymore. So the Ford was trying to control the market and basically stamp out the motor car being this adaptable device that could be used for many other devices as a stationary source of power or as a tractor, and turn it back into just the motor cars we know it today. And if you trace the history of that, in fact, what happened, that slowly over time, all these other uses vanished. And of course, we know today that your motor car, you don't see anybody jack it up to power the domestic washing machine or anything like that, or use it to turn it into a tractor. And so this is the dynamic between the users who often innovate technology. Many new technologies come from users taking a standard technology and doing something interesting with it. The manufacturers, often the engineers, the designers of technology, responding to those things that the wider public are doing. And this is the sort of contorted path of history of technology you often find. So for us in social construction technology, just to amplify that, is that we are very interested in the meanings of technology, which humans, users of technology, typically have, and how engineers and designers respond to those meanings. Mm-hmm. And that you can trace this interaction between, we call them, the meanings shared by social groups around technology and the designers and engineers of technology. There's an interaction between the two, a dialectic between the two, and this leads to new paths for technological artifacts to develop in. The ordinary bicycle, the transition from the penny farthing, which was used to actually be called the ordinary bicycle. You know those bicycles with those very huge wheels that people used to ride on?
Yeah.
Those were used, that was the very first bicycle in the 1880s, used by young men, and here, the gender of the technology can be important, for sporting use, for showing off. But there were other users out there who wanted a different thing for the bicycle. They wanted it as a source of transport. And that high wheel is incredibly unstable. This is before you had proper paved roads. You hit a stone with that high wheel bicycle and you did something called doing a header. Just go straight over the top. So it's actually a very dangerous machine and only used by very young men who wanted to show off. But there were other users, women users, older people who didn't want to do that. They wanted it for transport. And you can trace the history of the safety bicycle, as it's called, the standard bicycle, where you have two wheels the same size, you have a rubber tire, and your weight is over the back drive, basically. And that emerges from engineers responding to these groups of users, social groups, who prefer a safe bike rather than this macho show-off bike. So we trace the history of that. So that's the sort of stuff we do.
Yeah, that's very interesting, Trevor, because so it sounds like status symbol, like some people use now a car, an expensive car as a status symbol, because you said some man wanted to show off with a bike. So was a bike also really expensive those time when it got introduced? I guess so, or?
Yeah, it was. Yeah. It was not a cheap sport. And bikes, by the way, in response to these young men who wanted to show off, and the symbolism of technology is exactly right, your point of the status. The symbolism is very important in the history of technology as well, to understand how technology is a symbolic of things as well, of your identity. And they actually produced bigger and bigger front wheels. There was one bicycle, the Rudge Ordinary, I think it was called, had this gigantic front wheel. The only way you could get onto this bike was with a little wooden box and someone stabilizing the bike with you before it was kind of launched. So you needed two people to actually start on it. And that was one of the most dangerous big bikes out there. And that was in response to this kind of status symbol of showing off on this really expensive bicycle. And the history of bicycles is very interesting, because you get stability as well. You get long periods of stability. If you think of, you know, the safety bicycle developed in the 1890s, turn of the century, is a very stable technology for a long time, until you have another group of users in California in the 1970s and so on, who are developing, 1980s, developing the mountain bike. And that's really the first departure from the safety bicycle of any significance, is the development of the mountain bike. And again, it was a group of users who came up with that. They wanted to, you know, have fun going down these mountains in California. Mm-hmm. And that led to the mountain bike. So you have long periods of stability in technology. Society's fairly stable around it. But then you get moments of innovation, sometimes produced by users, and you get a change in the technology.
Right. So before we went to the bikes, we spoke about, in principle, how you would call it, repurposing. So, and nowadays, if I, for example, I remember some devices from Apple, I could not use it as I wanted to. So some modern devices or the big tech companies sometimes really are really interested to prevent any kind of repurposing. Even if you want, let's say, you want to make a photo with an early iPod, I think, was impossible, but you could make a movie. So, and then I asked myself, why is that? Do you have any insight? Obviously, that is about marketing, but is this also interesting from your perspective of science and technology studies?
Or
did something really change now? The world, let's say, is not a good place anymore, and the big tech companies tell us what to do, or what can you contribute from your big historic and analytic insights?
Well, I think this is a feature of capitalist development of technology, and it isn't just a modern thing. I mean, I gave that example earlier of Henry Ford refusing the Ford dealership to people who sold those kits. So very early on, manufacturers realized that at a certain point they don't want users messing with the technology for various reasons. And I think that has become what you're pointing out. I don't think all companies are the same, but Apple in particular doesn't like people to get inside the black box of the technology. So it makes it, people can still do that, but it makes it much harder to get in, you know, to get inside and mess with the technology, which some technologies, of course, you could do with early synthesizers. You can mess with them, get inside them. And lots of people have done this as a hobby, sort of. It's called hardware hacking, getting inside a piece of technology and repurposing it. And some of these repurposings of technology are really important. Here's a good example. DJ Theodore, who allegedly, and I think this is probably a true story, develops the scratch. We'll be right back. which is used in a form of DJing where you scratch on a vinyl record. And that's a really important genre of music, scratching. And he discovers it by accident. And suddenly, you know, the old vinyl record playing on the record player where we used to all listen to our Pink Floyd with in the early days has now become repurposed for making a new form of really exciting electronic music that, of course, you know, it's part of the rave scene in clubs and so on. And these, again, is an example of users repurposing. Who would have thought that a vinyl LP and record player could be used as a new source of sound in a genre of music? Life is full of these sorts of surprises and twists and turns. And this, again, is users repurposing. So although manufacturers don't like it, sometimes these repurposings can be incredibly important and lead to a whole new strand of technological artifacts, whole new forms of culture, like this new form of music.
So to understand this from the perspective of theory, so in the theory, as far as I understand it, I'm only definitely a layperson in sociology, so you have to use the technology, but we are speaking of something else, right? We are speaking of big tech companies, which could be like the third entity in the game. Is that what I just said, new idea to study, or is that already also what you have developed over the past decades? Or is it only there's this user and technology, but it really matters who produces the technology, I think, because nowadays some companies really want to steer our minds. They want to get as much attention. They want us that we get sucked into some online sites and spend more and click more. And I think that is a new phenomenon, isn't it?
Yeah, well, the whole, of course, with the internet and the development of internet and certain platforms becoming dominant, that's a very interesting phenomenon. But I'm a bit resistant to this being described entirely as a new phenomenon, because you go back to, I mean, it's not like big tech companies are new. It's just the word technology today, people often think of it just in terms of media, phones, computers. I think of technology in a much wider sense than that. That produces all sorts of artifacts. So Henry Ford again, you know, that's a big tech company, and they want to constrain what users can do back in, you know, in the 1930s. So it's not particularly new that you have big tech companies. The thing that's new is the way the users interact with these tech companies, which of course with online and with social media is a new phenomena. But you know, the overall principles I still see as the same, that you have manufacturers of technology, you have intermediaries, people that distribute this technology, sell this technology, and repair this technology, and you have users of the technology. Those are our key, I think, groups of thinking about technology. And you also have people, of course, who write about technology, and that's where often the symbolism of technology comes about through advertising and things like that. I don't see a fundamental change in the way, say, that Scott, social construction technology, would approach technology for today's. The internet is different. Each technology has its own, you know, specific relationships with users. And because the thing about the internet technology, extraordinary thing, social media, is how users have learned to give away their content of straight to the manufacturers, which then the manufacturers can exploit with advertising, as we know. But this may be something that's going to change. Of course, people are so worried about this now that there'll be more and more legislation stopping, you know, this Facebook and Google and so on from actually using our content however they want. I'm certain this is going to happen. And that's another, of course, important factor in the development of technology, institutions responding to it through legal processes, to try and push back on what these large capitalist companies can do.
Mm-hmm. So it's maybe, so, but there are differences, but maybe only, so maybe it's the scale of, or the scalability of technology maybe nowadays. For example, you can have a Zoom meeting, which is online with 1,000 people, if you will. And 20 years back, this was sort of, or maybe 30 years back, it was inconceivable. So the scaling that you can do sort of more and more people, you spend more time, but you wouldn't say you spend, let's say, more money, because those days where people bought this, as you said, macho bike or so, it was also pretty expensive. And nowadays we spend, or some people spend a decent fraction of their income to buy an very expensive iPhone, for example. And those things really did not change. But so what do you see any real changes? You said, in principle, you said no, but I think there are changes. What about the scale?
Well, it depends how you think about scale. Think about what happened when, you know, you could lay transatlantic cables for the first time, and you could have, you know, telephone calls across the world. And that was a huge change of scale, definitely. So these moments have happened before. It's very interesting, if you read into the history of technology, there's an interesting instrument called the telharmonium, which developed before even loudspeakers existed. And it was broadcast, it was a huge machine in the middle of Manhattan, and used telephone lines, and would offer menus of different sorts of music to bars and restaurants in Manhattan by the telephone. And again, this was in the turn of the 19th century. And you could choose your menu of different sorts of sounds piped in. So I always want to, you know, disturb people who say everything's different today by pointing out that there have been moments in the past where things have happened like this. The telegraph and the telephone produced initially that huge change of scale where you could send messages around the world instantly. Of course, it's now we have video around the world, and that is a new phenomena. But the important point to bear in mind is that these changes of scale have happened before. So if you think of it as an issue of changing scale, yes, it's bigger than ever before. And we have new, in the word is affordances, new sorts of things we can do with the technology. But these moments have happened before, I would like to stress.
Mm-hmm. Let me try. Okay, I get your point, because obviously you're you have the access to like a tremendous amount of historical pathway that happened. So what about, for example, let's say user reviews on Amazon for books? It started with books. Amazon started with books, and now it's like one of the biggest company. And so that is definitely one example for what scalability does, because you just like approach much more people. But do you have also an example that something like that happened like decades back?
Yeah, no, the Amazon example is very interesting, because I actually did an early study of Amazon book reviewers, the top 1,000 book reviewers of Amazon when it was just a book company. And we traced how it starts. And there's a guy actually in a warehouse at Amazon who posts to the Amazon had this website, who posted the first ever book review there. And Amazon suddenly realized, wow, they used to employ book editors they pay a large amount of money to, who would do these kind of official reviews on the Amazon site. And they suddenly realized, hey, we can get users to do this and save a ton of money. And of course, it's the first exploitation again of user content, and they encouraged that. And of course, it's developed the whole user review system. But again, if you trace this back in history, you'll find things like in Britain, we have the good old AA, Automobile Association, and they would always produce, you know, sort of like a club for people who own cars that could join, and they would review hotels you could stay in as you were traveling around Britain. You know, the AA would review hotels. So if you were a member of the Automobile Association, you had access to those reviews, and they even would have different starred reviews. So, you know, you'd find like this bed and breakfast is a 2-starred AA. And this is way before the internet. So people were doing these kind of reviews, user reviews, using, you know, older technology, obviously, print technology, before the internet, you know, the people at Amazon stumbled into it. But the scale, you're right, the scale is much more massive today. And it's a huge thing. But it did exist before. I'd just like to point that out. There were precedents to it.
Yeah. Okay. Then let's say I give up. So there may be quantitative changes, but there are not really new things emerged, at least compared to what actually you know. One part of the theory which I came across, I wanted to ask you. Let me just like read off. So it's about the actor network theory. So as you may know, I'm very active in network theory, but not so much the actor network theory. And for me, Network dynamics is very important, where new links are permanently established or removed, and the dynamics, let's say the traffic network or other socioeconomic networks, are very important, because almost all pressing problems we are facing today are related to networks, be it like mass migration to traffic jams and so on. So let me just like pick up one thing I prepared here. So I'm talking about ANT. So the actor network theory is a theoretical and methodological approach to
listen and repeat.
Methodological.
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 Social theory, where everything in the social and natural worlds exist in constantly shifting networks of relationships. So for me, that does not make any sense. Why everything is constantly shifting? I understand that there's a dynamics, but what is your point to this ANT theory? Because I have read that at least you contributed to that, or you have been in touch with that. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, I haven't contributed it to it, actually. But the history of our field is there were a number of people who worked on science before they moved over to technology. The field was called the sociology of scientific knowledge. And there were a bunch of us who moved over to study technology. And I have a good close friend and colleague from the early days who did that as well. He's now become quite well known. His name is Bruno Latour, and he's one of the originators of what's so-called actor network theory is. And his innovation was, while we focused mainly in social construction of science and social construction of technology on the kind of humans and how humans shape technology and how humans responded as well to those technologies. It was kind of a mutual process between, as we talked about earlier, backwards and forwards. The big innovation that Bruno Latour and his colleague Michel Canon at L'École de Mines in Paris, where this whole approach was developed, was to think about the role of non-humans. And so this is where they came up with actor network theory. They thought of, let's give the non-humans, the machines, the millions of different sorts of non-humans, but in the same status as the humans in the network. And let's develop a new, what they call a sociology of translations, where we can talk about how humans and non-humans work together in these complicated networks. And that's the origin of actor network theory. And it's become probably the best known approach in science and technology studies. And Bruno Latour, of course, has gone on to much greater fame as a well-known wider philosopher in this whole field. But some of it, you say I contributed to it. Well, actually, I've been critical of it in the sense that I find it difficult to understand how you can treat humans and non-humans equivalently, because it seems to me that they are different things. And I'm an old-fashioned humanist, and I kind of value the humans in networks. And it reduces the possibility of what I would see as using sociological ideas to explain technology, if you level the playing field between humans and non-humans. Because it's obvious that, so we have theories about what humans can do. They can be socialized. We have complicated theories of how, in sociology, how things work with humans. But most of these can't apply to non-humans, because it doesn't make any sense to talk about, how is an electron socialized? It's a strange thing. And also, the other problem I'd point to is there are way more non-humans in the world than humans. So in a typical room, you may have, let's go back before the pandemic, you have a seminar with 12 students and a professor, say, you've got 13 humans in the room. And how many non-humans are there? Well, I did one of my early studies in physics of development of solar neutrino astronomy. Well, there's billions of neutrinos being produced by the sun every second, passing through us all the time, because they only interact by what's known as the weak interaction, so they're incredibly hard to detect. But they're all non-human, so they're just take one tiny little thing, billions of neutrinos. And so you have to, obviously, the issue then becomes, and they're very smart about this actor network theory, people have thought about this issue, is which non-humans do you consider? in the network.
But Trevor, I mean, I haven't really studied these N theory, but it sounds to me that is a little bit unfair what you say. I mean, they would consider non-human actors which sort of interact with the humans. And you just like, you gave an example of neutrinos which don't interact with anything. So that I think is a little bit unfair. So
probably, yeah. let me just defend myself. Yeah. It is a conceptual issue that if you focus on humans, right, it's relatively easy to tell who the humans are, right? We know, there's no ambiguity who the humans in that seminar room are. If you've got problems that you can't identify them, well, that's really weird. You know, you shouldn't probably be doing social. You shouldn't probably be in the room if you can't identify who the humans are. But it's much more difficult to think about all the non-humans because there are many more of them. So it may be unfair that as an example, but the things we interact with in the room, we're interacting with the air we breathe, right? The oxygen in the room, we're interacting with that. Is that significant for studying the development of a particular technology? Probably not. And maybe it is, I don't know. But there are many more non-humans we interact with. And the nice thing about humans, if you're do ethnography and interviewing like I do, you can talk to the humans, you can interview them. That's what I do is my methodology. I go around the world interviewing scientists and engineers often, or doing what we call participant observation study, where I sit with a group and get to see how they see the world. It's much harder to do that for non-humans. You know, how do electrons see the world? You're interacting with them. You can't interview electrons. You can't hang out with them. So it may sound silly and unfair, but I think these are kind of profound. If you are a humanistic sociologist of science, like I was now sociologist of technology, ingrained in what we call the interpretive method of social science, hermeneutic method, it's much harder to approach the non-humans. And this wonderful new approach by Bruno Latour and Michel Callard, of course, enables in some ways us to do that. That's the trick of actor network theory, but you certainly can't, you have to abandon these kind of methods that I've been talking about. And that's what, and they would agree with that as well. They would say we require new kinds of methods to study these kind of networks.
I see. So what are the inventors of AND or the protagonists actually claiming to better describe or to explain what previous theories could not? So what is the main existence for that?
Yeah, so let me give you a contrast. Sorry. Yeah, let me give you a contrast between an example I talked about earlier, the electronic music synthesizer. So what's powerful about the social construction technology is that it shows you how artifacts are invisible carriers of social relations, you know, the stuff that's embedded in the artifact, so that when you see a synthesizer, you know, if you're a sociologist of technology, you understand something about the history of that instrument, you can unpack it, we call it opening the black box, and see the social relations that are embedded in that particular artifact. Where with actor network theory, what it's stronger at is seeing how that particular artifact is re-embedded into society, into a network. So you could study how is that synthesizer taken up by a group of users. Say it's used at a music school. How is it used at the music school, the synthesizer? What new sorts of relations are produced between the teachers and the students around that synthesizer? So it's a different thing. Its strength is that it's very good at seeing how these artifacts are embedded back into society and often also how they're produced by networks as well. It also can say something about that. But the power of the Scott approach is in just seeing how those artifacts alone are very powerful things. So you probably need both, actually.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so let us go back to music. So you said you also performed music, and I looked it up a little bit. So you were like a fan of psychedelic music. And so you performed like acid space rock. So I must say I'm not a fan of rock because I don't like this 4/4 meter. So what is your, did music help you, let's say, to make a living at Cornell, or what part, so how your musical activity sort of shaped you in your career, if it's true at all. I mean, obviously it shapes you in your personal life. I understand that, but did it also help you in your career? Or what is the main interaction?
Well, first one thing I have to disabuse you of is that the fact that you can make a living from it. I mean, I have so many musician friends, and I've interviewed many very successful musicians, and they're all kind of broke. You don't make money. And there's a few, you know, incredibly wealthy musicians, but the story is that most musicians don't make money and they're struggling. So
if you could have made money, you would maybe have stayed there in music?
I spent a year doing experimental psychedelic rock, and I realized it was going to be a very hard career. And this possibility of doing a master's in science studies, and you know, the academic career looked a much safer bet, and I enjoyed doing the academic work, but I always kept my interest in music. In London, I was the music correspondent for London University newspaper. That's how I got a start in kind of music stuff there. And there was an early music society called the Electronic Music Society at Imperial College when I was an undergrad. And then that's how I got into synthesizers. For me, the most important thing has been that keeping in touch with the electronic music world and performing has been a really nice way to interact with the musicians and engineers who I study. So for instance, I built my own synthesizer. I had a physics background, and I built a synthesizer in the early 70s in London using the physics workshops at Imperial College. And when I went to interview Robert Moog, you know, the engineer who develops the Moog synthesizer, Bob, as we called him, Bob Moog, was not very impressed by the fact I was a professor at Cornell University, but he was kind of interested that I built my own synthesizer. Mm-hmm. And we bonded more than that. So the fact that I perform electronic music and build synthesizers gives me a nice entry into that community, where it's no longer me necessarily studying them, but we have a much more equal relationship. Where I'm a co-participant. They know I make the music, and that gives greater respect for me and a better relationship with them. So that's been one of the most important things. I mean, I love music as well. Music is so important. And in London, we used to listen to a band called Hawkwind. You'd probably hate, they did an early form of space rock like the Pink Floyd, and it was pretty 4/4. And, but I mean, there's obviously all sorts of much more refined electronic music, which gets beyond that, that you can listen to. But that was the stuff that I was kind of bored up on. And I do more ambient stuff now, so it's a long way away from rhythmic. These are analog synthesizers, find it really hard to do 4/4. I have a digital colleague who can do that. With digital apps, you can do much more in terms of rhythm. I'm more in terms of drones and the texture of sound. And these drones slowly evolve. And that's more what I do. You know, you can think of someone like Terry Riley would be someone who would be an inspiration for the sort of thing I do.
Okay. Bob Moog, I read that when he sold the first Mini Moogs, or the first synthesizer, he went sometimes like over many hundreds of kilometers with a Greyhound bus to approach his customers. Is that true, or is that like?
Well, there's a couple of stories here. First, this is not about the Mini Moog. The Greyhound bus story is about the modular Moog, which is a gigantic instrument. You know, it's like an old analog telephone exchange. So this is the Mini Moog has a built-in keyboard. This is before you have built-in keyboards. You can attach the keyboard. You have these quarter-inch jack leads. It's called patching the synthesizer. That's how you control, you know, the modules are interlinked by these patch wires. And they're huge machines, and they cost a fortune, by the way, back in the day, 1964, 65, 66, these early days. You know, it would a big full Moog modular synthesizer and a tape recorder, which you needed with it, could cost you the price of a small house. They were that expensive.
Okay, then it makes sense that you need to develop a personal relationship with your customers also. Yeah,
so, let me just tell you the Greyhound bus story, because it's kind of cute. Sorry to interrupt you. His factory, Cornell University, is centrally isolated. It's the joke if you live up here. It's 5 hours from anywhere you want to be, any big city, you know, Philly, Boston, Montreal, New York City. They're about 5 hours away driving. So we're centrally isolated. Where Robert Moog chose to make his factory and studio is even more isolated, a tiny place called Trumansburg, north of Ithaca, where Cornell University is, really in the middle of nowhere. Most of his early customers who could afford this instrument, they'd use it for advertising, ballet, or Wendy Carlos, who used it to make that record Switched on Bach, which is one of the biggest Moog records ever, were down in New York City. They could afford this instrument. And how is Bob Moog going to get this instrument down to New York City? Well, he put it on the Greyhound bus and he packed it up in cardboard, slipped it down the Greyhound bus, then took a cab to these individual musician studios. So that was the Greyhound bus story. But the Mini Moog, which is developed a bit later in 1970, the first portable electronic music synthesizer, is the first synthesizer to get into retail music stores. And this is another important part of the history of technology we haven't talked about. Technologies have to be marketed and sold to users. And if you can get a synthesizer into a retail music store where most instruments are sold, then that's going to be massive in terms of the audience you can reach or the numbers of consumers you can reach who might be interested in this new instrument. So there's a whole story in my book about the history of the synthesizer analog days. I tracked down the salesman who does this. He's a TV evangelist who has switched to becoming an evangelist about synthesizers. And he literally goes around America in his Cadillac with six Mini Moogs in the back of the Cadillac, goes to retail music stores and persuades them to stock this new instrument, which was not a trivial thing, because even the Mini Moog was pretty expensive. And it's an analog, still pretty complicated instrument. It doesn't have those patch wires, but it's got something like 43 knobs and switches on it. So it's quite a complicated instrument to sell in retail music stores. And this guy, David Van Kuring, succeeded in doing that. So that's the kind of story. Again, it's a story of mobility, you know, Greyhound buses, Cadillac cars. This is a real American salesman style stories. Yeah. But they're true.
Okay, I see. Mobility. So the current mobility heads towards maybe autonomous driving and self-driving cars. And I would like to ask you, so in principle, you mentioned sort of trust also. So there's a problem. You said you don't really trust Siri. Would you consider to buy a self-driving car? Do we trust the technology? And obviously, can you say a little bit what maybe are the same aspects one has to consider given this brand new technology compared to what you know from other technologies?
Yeah, well, I suspect that it's a really great question, and because it's to do as well with thinking about the systems behind these self-driving cars, artificial intelligence, deep learning, the technology it's based upon. So you have to think about those. And then what is going to be the use of these self-driving cars? I find it, if somebody said, here's a self-driving car that you're going to use just on the open road, say where you live in Ithaca, New York, I'd say you're crazy. This is because these artificial intelligence systems, they're incredibly impressive. And I've worked a little bit with Cornell Tech, with a guy who's an expert on this, Serge Belanger. So I know a little bit about it. That was a project to teach computers to recognize musical instruments using deep learning. The problem is, it's a problem that goes back to the philosopher Wittgenstein, is the rules to interpret the rules. No rule stands on its own. It always has to be interpreted in a context. And this is the thing that AI finds so hard to do. And we can program in algorithms, you can have deep learning, but the context for where motor vehicles operate are almost, you know, they're not quite infinite, but there's a huge number of them. And there's all sorts of subtleties involved. You know, when a pedestrian is crossing the road and you're in a car, you might establish eye contact with that pedestrian to show that you've each recognized each other. Now, can the deep learning on the autonomous car, can it take into account those subtleties? And, you know, if you're a skilled human in this society, what you do is you kind of learn from experience how to interpret rules in a context. And that's the thing that I think AI finds the hardest to do. So I'd be deeply skeptical if you could have a car that could go into the open road, but where they might be useful. And then this is, again, I pointed to this earlier, us humans are incredibly good at repairing the deficiencies of technology and somehow accounting for them. So I could imagine that, on certain sorts of road that especially allowed for self-driving vehicles, or in certain circumstances, when you're on a pretty straight road and you know you're caught in traffic and crawling, you could at that moment switch over to the autonomous driving system. So I think that's how they'll be used initially. And of course, you always have to think, you know, road traveling by car anyway is incredibly dangerous, a huge number of accidents. And it may be the case that eventually in these limited uses that it will reduce the number of accidents. And that's a great thing, of course. But I'm very skeptical about whether it will manage in, you know, the open road situation, which is so complicated by people and all sorts of strange things that humans do when they maneuver their cars.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great, great answer. So you mentioned like accidents. So people definitely are concerned when it comes to self-driving cars because of the accidents of Tesla cars and other semi-autonomous cars. I mean, not yet. We are really at the level where the technology is ready for this. As you said, it just comes like to prediction of pedestrians, which requires reasoning and neither deep learning nor any kind of AI is pretty close to it. Everyone is working on that, but that may delay really the technology. So, but the point is, let's say it will happen, and it cannot be really avoided that people die on the street from autonomous cars, as they also die from cars which are not self-driving, which you and me are driving. Do you have an example from your broad historic overview where an introduction of technology also led to death and people sort of got used to it, or what happens then? Is there something? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I can give you an example. The work was done by a former graduate student of mine who now teaches at Bristol University Sociology Department in the UK, John Downer. And he wrote his dissertation on the history of aircraft safety. And this is really a fascinating history, because I don't know if you can hear that before you or I were born, there were these aircraft called the Comets in the 1950s that kept crashing. And in fact, what John shows is the history of the aircraft industry has been from this amazingly dangerous, this is commercial passenger aircraft industry, to one of the safest in the world today in terms of accidents. And he looks at what leads to those developments. And one of the things is, it's quite clear that humans have learned from accidents, but these accidents are kind of inevitable because no one can predict exactly what's going to happen with these very, very complicated pieces of technology that put in new situations. So things like, you know, I think the early comet crashes had the wrong shaped windows. No one understood that, you know, you needed a particular shape of window to avoid crashing the airplane.
Yeah, interesting thing. Why plane crashed? Actually, early on, the plane had rectangular windows because why not? But the corners here would exert a lot of stress to the surrounding metal, leading to cracks sometimes. And that's the reason why they crashed. And now all planes have oval windows. And the stress around the oval window is not as high as before.
And most aircraft accidents are very hard to predict. So in fact, large numbers of humans, I mean, this is in a sense a bad and a good story, have died in the development of this industry, but it's got safer. The good part is it's got safer and safer over time. But what John Danner argues is that that's the way it's inevitably got to be. There's certain sorts of accidents that are just unpredictable because of the complexity of the technology involved. But the smart thing is to learn from those accidents, to make certain that such an accident will never happen again. So if you think of self-driving cars, you think of the aircraft industry. I mean, we've had the crash of these Boeings. This is another great, you know, an example of it. And the, you know, Boeing is learning from that to better design aircraft so that software glitch, now that it's becoming more software errors. It's another whole new layer of complexity in aircraft design with software. And so humans have kind of, it's not, well, no one intended this. You can't say we plan, you know, N accidents a year and these humans will die and we'll learn from it. But historically, it's evolved in that way that humans have actually died people have died, to make this industry a better industry. And one could argue that if that's so, then maybe the self-driving car industry will be like that as well. Mm-hmm. It's kind of interesting when you think about that, you know, people, you know, one driver in a Tesla car is killed and everyone says, oh my God, this technology is going to be a mess and really dangerous. But, you know, if you think of the large numbers of people in plane crashes who died, you know, it's a different scale. And so you could, but it's hard to make that sort of argument, like straight off knowing the technology is dangerous. You kind of have to assume it's going to be safe until proven otherwise.
So what, so let's say I'm a car manufacturer and I want to convince people to buy my self-driving car, and it's clear it's not 100% safe, as every technology is not 100%, but obviously the company would try to convince you that they do the best to make it as safe as possible. Is there something from history you can learn to, as me as a car manufacturer right now, to speed up this process? Or do we just like have to wait until people die and obviously the technology gets better and better? Is there anything one can do better, or what we have learned from the past? Is there something you could recommend for those people? I mean, I don't get financial benefits from them, but let me just ask you that question.
Well, if I knew the answer to that, of course, yeah, I'd be keeping it to myself. I'd be becoming a wealthy guy. I'd be, you know, must be on the phone all the day. You know, Trevor, can I have some tips? But I don't have, there's no magic solution here to learn, because each historical context is different. The users involved are different. The period is different. The safety regulations are different. One thing we do know is unintended consequences. This is something we learn in the history of technology, that unintended consequences are a thing that happens. And you can learn from, say, overcomplicated pieces of technology. The Challenger accident, the space shuttle, is a great example of this, that technologies that are so, so complicated, things will be going wrong all the time. Those are hard things to innovate and develop. But the self-driving car isn't going to be like that. It's going to be complicated, but it'll be as kind of standardized by the time it's manufactured piece of technology. So I think I'm waffling here. I don't think there's any easy lessons to be learned from history here, other than, you know, be careful, pay attention to the role of the humans in developing the technology, the users of the technology as well. And remember that some of these industries that are promoting the technology, particularly artificial intelligence, there's an enormous amount of hype attached to these industries. And they often, the history of AI has been that it predicts it can do more than it can do. And I'm certain people who manufacture cars are aware of that, but don't get taken in by the hype as well. Would be one of the, by the way, this is an interesting thing. The history of artificial intelligence, as told by professional historians, is in its infancy as a field. I have a close colleague at Cornell, I mentioned him before, Ronald Klein, who's an outstanding world famous historian of technology, who written a marvelous book on the history of cybernetics. And he's starting to do research now for a book on the history of artificial intelligence. And what he says to me is, so there's very few articles actually on the history of artificial intelligence. There's users' accounts and, you know, proponents' accounts, people who are in the field as philosophers writing about it. But there's very little actual good history on, you know, fascinating debates about, say, the development of neural nets, which, you know, was developed at the perceptron, developed at Cornell, actually, my own university, and lost out to people like Marvin Minsky for a different version of AI. You know, it's known as, you know, symbolic AI won out those debates. And it turned out the perceptron, the neural net approach, which was then in its infancy, turned out to be a much more powerful approach. And so there's an interesting controversy there in the history of AI. And that's been written about, but very little has. I'm always a bit cautious of AI because there's so much hype around it.
Trevor, thanks a lot.
Well, thank you for inviting me, Jan. It was a pleasure. It was fun. And I hope all the people out there listening, watching, will get something from this. But thanks for doing it.
Maybe one last comment. There is a hype around AI, that is true, but it's also backed up by a lot of milestones. No matter what you think,
the best is yet to come.